said, it's a great pleasure to introduce to some of you, and welcome back to others of you, my colleague, Curt Collier. He's a powerhouse in so many ways, and I'm glad you've got the listening devices, because although you might be able to hear him otherwise, you don't want to miss a word. He is also Deputy Director of Groundworks. He is dedicated to the environment and to ethical culture. I think those are his passions, and he's going to share that passion with you. Curt.
And thanks for Ann for bringing yellow roses of Texas for my birthday. I appreciate that. I'm the square root of 2,704, so today, okay, this week. So it's nice to have that. I have to tell you how excited I am to have Kate here, because years ago, Kate and I lived together in the Bronx when she was it's funny to say, an intern in training at the Riverdale Yonkers Society, and I was the leader there, because I learned so much from her as well. And it was really those conversations sitting at Cambridge when we started talking about food and veganism and vegetarianism and all the different things that really started me definitely on the path of thinking about issues around food and farming and where things came from and all that stuff. How many of you have gone over now to the Grand Central Station and seen their exhibit on the 100th anniversary of Grand Central Station? Have you seen it? It's in Vanderbilt Hall. And you go there, and they've got a bunch of cute exhibits. You know, it's a nice Sunday. You can go over there later this afternoon and go check it out. They got a bunch of old pictures of New York and before the Grand Central Terminals were built, and what a horrible person Cornelius Vanderbilt was. And all those things. It's really, really interesting learning the history. What I'm fascinated about is looking at old pictures of New York City. I mean, even in the 1880s, New York City was a metropolis, right? It was just, you look at these buildings and you think of, you know, what the rest of America looked like. And then you see New York and they have these skyscrapers, buildings and all this kind of stuff. Such a long time ago, and you forget what an amazing place this has been for so long. So here's an interesting question. When did the last farm close in Manhattan? Come on, you people, you'll read everything. 1930s, it was located, the last one was at Broadway and 214th Street. And I have this cute little quote from Josephine Benedetto Bliani, obviously must have been an Italian immigrant, lived there with her family, and she wrote to her historian years later what it was like to live on the farm. She said, our farm had very good soil. They had the best corn. They were small because there wasn't a lot of room, but they were round and delicious. We raised all different kinds of vegetables. We had tomatoes, corn, lettuce, and string beans. We had pear trees and peach trees, and we had chickens, rabbits, and a goat. We rented a horse when we had to do the plowing. We're still plowing with a horse. My parents earned their living selling the eggs, vegetables, and fruit. And that was from her 1920s diary, which she had put in there. So it's interesting to think that even in this megapolis, this big, huge, gorgeous city that y'all have here, that agriculture was still a teeny tiny piece as late as the 1930s. You know, in 1942, as I've said many times, almost half of Americans still lived in a rural environment. 48% of us were still living in a rural environment. During that time, about 35% of us made full-time income off of the farms in the 1940s. 35% of Americans were still making plenty of money off of the farms. What percentage is it today? I've thrown this out before. Do you remember? Yeah, so it's less than a half a percent. So it's less than 0.5% of Americans currently are farmers in this country. So this figure, as you can imagine, has dropped quite significantly. And it's amazing. I mean, when you study these things and you read all about it and you're involved in all the dialogues and the debates, that's the topic everybody's talking about, at least in the circles I go into, is what happened to farming in America, because it happened in your lifetimes, right? In your lifetimes, we changed agriculture dramatically. And most of us have this image of what agriculture is. So there we are watching the Super Bowl, and I really didn't care about either team. Although I wanted Baltimore to win because, you know, the city that wins gets an economic boost, and Baltimore needed that. Not more than San Francisco. But there's this wonderful commercial that comes in with Paul Harvey. Y'all remember that?
Yeah.
Paul Harvey, the old radio guy. I loved Paul Harvey as a kid. What was this? His radio show was called? One of his many. He had this Saturday news report, you know, next page. And then he always he had a bunch of things. And he was a myth himself. He knew he was a myth. He was living, created all these images about himself. But he also had a show called The Rest of the Story. Now we hear the rest. Y'all know Paul Harvey? Raise your hand if you knew who he was. Yes, you've heard him. So anyway, there's, and it says Paul Harvey. Also, this iconic black and white image has come up of the American farmer. And I'm looking at this. The first thing is Paul Harvey is doing one of his beautiful jobs, once again, of saying what a great, hard-working person the American farmer is. And it goes, as if the rest of us don't work hard. And it goes on and on and on about this kind of stuff. And there are images of these struggling white farmers, you know, and weather-beaten and broken nails and standing there looking extremely like farmers. You like, you think the image goes. I'm listening to this commercial, and I thought, that's it? It's such a myth. I'm watching this commercial for Dodge trucks. Ultimately, it's about Dodge trucks. But they go out to the Midwest. It's definitely a red-blue commercial, red-blue state commercial. And they're showing these images of the farmer and everything else. Like I said, the American farmer looks nothing like that. The percentages are very few. The majority of American farmers today, majority, what do they look like? Hispanic males. In fact, almost half of the current farmers in the United States were born in foreign countries, of that 0.5%, right? So the whole image of the American farmer supplying all the food, and those of us who listen to the farm bill debates, all this stuff going, it's an illusion. It's a proud illusion that we've concocted about the American farmer. And to a certain extent, that person doesn't exist. I would love to see that person come back, and I would love to see the resurgence of that person. But it's, we need to think about realities, not just illusions. You know, how many of you have been to Old Sturbridge Village? It's a reconstructed village. Yeah, it's a really great. The next time you go there, it's in the border of Massachusetts and Connecticut, just north of Hartford. And there's this reconstruction of what a village would have looked like in the United States in the 1880s. It's really fun to walk around. They got old mills and stuff like that. And you can see the kind of turning point between the agrarian and the industrial America. And they've got this one little building sits off by itself. It looks totally out of place because it was funded through a different thing. It looks modern. And you walk in there, and it's an exhibit about what happened to the American farm. Really, they documented the fact that they already knew what was happening to the farm, and that the numbers had dwindled quite a bit. So I love the fact that Old Sturbridge Village does that. The problem with most of these farms, and if you get under 100 acres, your problem is going to be is it's just not going to be productive enough to make enough money to supply the wealth that you need just for your family, much alone for many other people. We have large numbers of farmers in the United States who basically live subsistently, right? What they did is they made all their food, they made maybe some extra money selling goats so they could keep just ahead of the bills, but the vast majority of them were not building much wealth. You really needed lots of land and a lot of acreage. And luckily it was the Industrial Revolution that came in and supplied much of the energy we needed to produce those big, huge productive farms. And so large numbers of people, frankly, just like today, can't make the money of it, right? My brother's wife's family has 2,400 acres in Texas and 600 head of cattle. Not one of them works as a full-time rancher anymore. They're all cottage farmers in a way because they all have other jobs to really support themselves, and they farm 2,400 acres on the side. Which is fine because I get 200 acres when my brother dies. So I'm hoping that either one of them goes quickly and I have all this land. So we're hoping for that. There was this classic debate between Alexander Hamilton and Thomas Jefferson about what kind of economy he wanted for the American. It's a classic debate, you know, many of you probably studied in school and stuff. Jefferson, of course, wanted an agrarian society. His idea is that there would be yeoman farmers, and if you were probably wealthy or wide enough, you could own a piece of land, and you would basically make sure democracy continued because you'd be independent and self-supporting in your own self. Right? His vision of support of society is we needed independent, self-supporting farmers to ensure the roots of democracy going on forward. Hamilton correctly realized that, well, you're not really building much wealth in these small, farms, and the chances of us really creating a democracy are not about that. Hamilton, of course, was more for creating a more centralized government rather than the states' rights of Jefferson. And that what we should be doing is backing our, putting our future in industrialization. So they had this big debate between the agrarian Jefferson and the industrial, pro-industrial side of Hamilton. And of course, Hamilton won out. One of the things, of course, that made it possible for America to get so much wealth, of course, is because we went into industry, they said. And because we had money, because we had an industry, we basically, during World War II and World War I, had the strength to rise to military might and become the world power. If we would have remained an agrarian society, we probably would not have the industrial base nor the wealth that was needed to fuel such massive war efforts, some people say. And so, however you look at history, and if we can debate that in some other fun topic, in a way it's kind of good that Hamilton won out in the short term. But that's not entirely what Jefferson was really getting at. Jefferson's fear was that the problem with the mill is that the owner is just one person, as opposed to the farmer, which we all have a stake in the future of our country. That's really what Jefferson was trying to say. He was fearful where we would all leave our lands, become landless people, go off into the, you know, the cities, join mills owned by one person. And then the whole power dynamic in the country shifts, and that's essentially what he was afraid of. To that extent, Jefferson got it exactly right. Because something happened when we did away with the American farm. We shifted how we grow food and how we think about food. Of course, farms, when we went through mechanized agriculture, and of course to do that, you need bigger and bigger pieces of land, not smaller. Right? It's very, very, very difficult to live off of even 100 acres if you have four people. There's almost not even enough calories in some way if you're bringing in dairy cows and things like that. For a family of four and 100 acres, there's just too many Americans, so that we just can't kind of support that kind of thing. But that's what he was talking about, is what also we gain by building communities around people who are invested into their food and their food production and things like that. Because when we got rid of all of that, when we went down to where there are just a few people now growing our food, most American food in this country is produced by, in the United States, is produced by how many companies?
3 to 5.
Yeah, 3 to 5, depending on how big you think they are. 3 to 5 companies in the United States control almost all of our food and food production system. Right? That is frightening. That is certainly the thing that Jefferson was trying to protect us from. And to a certain extent, when the bottom line became the reason how we set up our food and how we describe our food, when that became the motive, how much money we make, something shifted in America as far as our food production. Agriculture was more than just about the bottom line. It was about communities. It was about people making local decisions. You used to go into New Jersey and people tell me that they'd go over there to get one kind of tomato, or they would go over to Long Island to get another kind of potato. And there was something about these unique foods as you traveled across the United States. All of that is almost completely wiped out. Right now, I can walk into California or Washington, D.C. or Washington State and basically find one or two types of tomatoes or potatoes grown nationwide. So we put ourselves more at risk for that, because if you get, just like with the Irish potato famine, you all of a sudden you have a type of disease that comes in and can wipe out our entire food supply. But we seem not to be too interested in that. So we've lost something. We've lost something that Jefferson was afraid of that we would lose. Then we went to a more industrial system that was aggregated into the hands of a few large people who had the money to do that. You know, Charles Goodrich wrote a poem called Truck Garden, and I just want to, it's a piece of this. He says, "My first wife and I rented a little bungalow in the center of town. We were young. Our furniture was nothing but apple crates. The backyard butted up to a Ford dealer. There was a wall of new pickup trucks at the end of our garden. We planted everything we could dream of, even rutabagas. We had sweet peas climbing the downspouts. I grew peanuts in buckets on the back porch. She brought home two kittens, Basil and Sage, but they both died, and we buried them under the juniper. Before anything was ripe, the Ford guy bought the place, evicted us, bulldozed the house, and paved the yard. 30 years later, I still think of those cats buried beneath the asphalt, and who knows what else. And what I like about that poem, instead of its imagery, is what else had we lost? What else went away when we went into industrial agriculture and we made all these choices? And I've talked about this before. Agriculture in the United States changed for lots of different reasons. And one of the biggest impacts, of course, was World War II. The United States, rightly so, geared up to become a war machine. And one of the things we needed was chemicals and explosives. We needed a vast number of these things. And so we built factories, and these small chemical companies just boomed during the wars. They just turned out one chemical after another for the war effort. After the war, when all these young men were returning, the chemical factories came to the government and said, well, we're just not going to shut down. You'd lose so much. You'd lose jobs. Surely we got to keep these factories going. But what do you need ammonium nitrate for? What do you need explosives for? You know, that's what brought down the Murrah building in Oklahoma City, was ammonium nitrate. Well, the government basically went to the USDA, says, can you find any reason for ammonium nitrate to use that? And of course, the government says, sure, it works as great as a fertilizer. Why don't you just do that? And then we pushed this huge movement in the United States to get farmers to grow using chemicals, and because we had them and we needed to keep the jobs going. And it worked for a great time. American yields skyrocketed. Used to get somewhere around 12 bushels of corn off of 1 acre, 12 bushels, right? We had pushed that up to 212 bushels of corn off 1 acre. I remember as a kid, you planted corn here, and then here, and then here, because we lived in a dry place, and now it grows like this. I'll never forget, I was in St. Louis, so I went down to the Mississippi River, and I was driving through just the back country, just kind of sightseeing, and I stopped my car and I said, oh my God, what is that? And I went out there, and the corn was 15 feet high, 15 feet high. I had never, ever seen corn that could grow like that. And at the time, I was impressed. And it wasn't until years later, and they were growing it like this, I'm like, how could they even do that? I mean, just think of the nutrient depletion to the soil from growing corn that close. And it wasn't until years later that I discovered what happened, is that they were pouring all of these chemicals on the ground, creating this whole agriculture system right now, which is completely based on fossil fuels. And of course we know, and I don't need to go into all that, that there's a target date on the end of those things. So we've created an entire agriculture system, just like we do our industry and everything else, based on fossil fuels that has a terminus date that no one's talking about and seems to be that much interested in. So something else happened in World War II that was very interesting. The U.S. Army wanted to make sure that men were eating enough calories for in the field, right? The U.S. Army had to mass produce lots of MREs, meals ready to eat, ship them off around the country and feed a massive war machine, all these men and women working out in the fields, and to make sure that they got enough nutrition for them. Because as you'd imagine in the day, if you were raised on a farm or you're eating fresh food and then you go off and you eat something that's been packaged months ago, you know, and it's dried, how many of you remember MREs, right? It's so funny, during the Hurricane Sandy, they came by and handed me an MREs when our house was heavily damaged. And I forgot them. My father used to bring them home from the military all the time, which was really kind of funny. And they taste about the same. They haven't gotten too much better. So the U.S. government was concerned about the men not eating enough of the kind of food. And so they went to the industry once again and said, is there a way to kind of make sure that they eat this? And they said, well, there are ways to flavor food, that we can add things to it that will make the men want to eat more than they traditionally would eat. It's because of that that America suddenly discovered that we can produce all of these new kinds of flavors and all these kinds of new esters and oils and put them in food to make us want to eat those foods. And it started in World War II. It suddenly now, it became a whole industry. The Riverdale Yonkers Society for Ethnic Culture used to have a lot of stock in international flavors and fragrances over here in New Jersey. Great company put stock in because they just went like this. And the Riverdale Society made a ton of money off of it. It wasn't until years later that I discovered what the hell that company was. It's like one of those things like, what are they doing? Well, so suddenly, scientists and the people who are in the food industry are trying to sell more food. Here's the problem with being a farmer. You make lettuce or you make corn or something like that, you take it to the market, and because Americans are used to paying very little for food and won't pay much for expensive food, of course, people didn't mind. So you got very little money. A farmer probably makes 20 cents off the dollar, the middleman makes about 80 cents, and the store makes, he makes about 70%, and the store makes about 30 cents off the food. Farmer got very little from that. And so when these big agriculture companies came along, of course, originally they knew they weren't making a lot of money then. But if you package food, if you process food, and you develop food items, you can get a higher return on the dollar. When I was working with the USDA, went over there to try and figure out how we could do this farm program, they took me to Hunts Point Terminal Market. The USDA guy says, well, you can grow tomatoes, and we got a bunch of tomatoes coming in, but if you put them in cute little packages with a cute little label, they'll buy, you can get a much higher price. Just do that thing, right? Harvest, put it in a cute little store-ready package, and then send it out, you're going to make so much money. Food industry started looking at processed foods, and the thing was, is if you eat too much of one food, there's a thing in your brain that says, that's too much of that. So what they have to do is to trick your brain not to say that that's enough. So what they've discovered are additives that go in the food that basically, like a rat in a lab, get you to eat more and continue to eat more even though you're supposed to do it. I'm standing up here today as an example of what you should not do. That's why I wanted. I've just done this just to prove that it could happen. I'm kind of like the guy who went around eating a supersized meat. That was it. And they discovered that same kind of thing, that if we take any kind of food product and we get the right kind of crisp and we get the right kind of flavors and we add all these things, you will eat massive amounts of it, even though it's loaded in salt, loaded in fat, loaded in sugars. Those things, those three things, fat, salt, and sugar, we are genetically programmed to need. When Australopithecus finally climbed down the trees and started running around the savannah, we needed those things in order to survive. Mother's milk is sweet, right? Lactose. It's sweet, it has a sugar in it, so babies naturally gravitate towards it so that they can get the fat that they need. Our body shuts down without salt. We are genetically programmed to have those things, and we used to live in a time when those things were not that available. Unfortunately, if you know that, and you know how to flavor enhance anything and spray it with a fragrance, you can get people to consume massive quantities of this stuff over and over again. Cheetos is the number one example of that, right? Cheetos puffs it up because when you eat it, it dissolves in your mouth and your body tricks your body to think you're not eating anything. So you say, well, I can have another one. That thing wasn't anything. That's just like a little piece of fluff. I can have all that and go with the whole bag. So they engineered food and sold it to us, and we are tricked into eating massive quantities of this junk, and we do it quite well. Billions of dollars spent on how to fragrance and flavor food, and billions of dollars on how to market and sell it to you, and it all worked, right? There was this great article, it was in New York Times Magazine, did you read that? It was, just came out about, what was the title of that thing? It was called, The Extraordinary Science of Addictive Junk Food by Michael Moss. He has a new book coming out, supposedly. How many of you read that article? Wasn't that scary? The rest of you need to go home right now and read it. Just stop right now and go and leave it home. He has a new book come out, which he called Sugar, Salt, Sugar, Fat, How the Food Giants Hooked Us. And it tells the story of a few of the people in the industry who were looking at the obesity numbers in this country and said, you know what? For whatever reason, we don't have to be good guys, but eventually they're going to come after us just like they came after big tobacco. And we need to start talking about this. They had to try in some conferences to say that this food is junk And we've become so good at it, we've addicted millions of Americans on this stuff, and eventually someone's going to figure that out and they're going to come with us for lawsuits. They came to the industry, they brought them all together, and the book, part of it, what it says is, the guy said, well, you know, we know that. And it's, you know, we just did that and we're about money. And we're going to continue to do that. Because we have the designer food, we're going to make as much money as we possibly can, and then we're going to get out, hopefully, of the industry. Or at least now start saying that we're trying to produce other kinds of alternatives, even though they're not, just to get in. So, as you imagine, we are all perfectly aware, and I don't need to repeat it here, how bad our food is for us. And you've all been taught not to buy anything processed, and you all do it anywhere, just like I do occasionally. And we all eat out, even though we, hamburgers and all the stuff you eat are fragranced. Just like when you buy a new car, or you buy a new laptop, it's got that smell in there. They manufactured all that food to get you and to hold you and become so addicted to this junk that you'll buy it and buy it even though it is killing you. So luckily there has been a revolt in this country to a certain extent. Now because I work in the environmental field, I am amazed at how many conferences are like slow food or locavores. You know, Barbara Kingsolver came up with her book about living and eating within everything within 100 miles and trying to live even season and created some food habits around that. But you meet a lot of locavores, you meet more and more people are into it. We probably at Groundwork get, I don't know, 8 or 9 invitations a month to speak at conferences around this topic. It's just such a hot item you would not believe. The number of farmers markets have boomed in this country. Right, they're growing at a rate of 750 a year in the United States. 750 new farmers markets a year in the United States. And it's rising exponentially. So more and more people are thinking about their food. They're wanting to stop eating this junk. They're thinking about the ingredients more and more, even though they're tricking you more and more with that. You know, the favorite game was, I remember years ago, when the first thing was the anti-sugar campaign, remember that? And they were all these commercials, and you were supposed to circle where how much sugar was in the item, and was most of it was usually the second ingredient was sugar. And so what they did is, they said, okay, we'll reduce the amount of sugar. How did they do it? They brewed about 32 other ingredients that are all sweeteners, and put them in there, but that knocks sugar way off the top of the list and put it down. Because now you're saying, oh, well, this doesn't have very much sugar at all. Look, it's all wheat and maltodextrous, and it's xanthan gum, and it's you know, lactose, fructose, you know, sucrose, whatever the hell they else put in there with these sugars. If you attend my afternoon workshop, I'll teach you all what the look of the label and what the truth is about that. And they started doing that. Yeah, that's how they did it, right? Monosodium glutamate. You know, they said, oh, everybody didn't want to eat that, even though I can't find a Chinese food place in the world that actually does. I see them in my own place. I said, you use MSG? They said, no. And I'm sitting there, there's the kitchen, and I'm seeing the guy throwing in the stuff. And I'm looking at it, that's monosodium glutamate. What is that? I doubt that very much was what he said, right? Because there's a way to open up and incite your taste buds on your tongue, so when you eat this horrible stuff in your body, it makes you crave more Chinese food. And yet we continue to do it. So there's been a revolution. All these people are now trying to eat locally, buy fresh. How many of you have you shopped in a farmer's market, co-ops, locavore type things? A lot of you did, right? And they've come back. I was kind of mad at Mehmet Oz, Dr. Oz. Did you see Times Magazine around September 12th? And he says, what to eat now? And he goes on in a very... He's a lovely guy, and I'm trying to get tickets for his show, so if you're in the connection somewhere, so I'm going to bring a bunch of my farmers to a show. I was upset about that article, though, because what he basically said is that, well, you know, there's no nutritional difference between food that you get in a farmer's market and stuff that you find for bird's value, fresh frozen. And he's correct. There are very few nutritional differences to a certain extent. But that's not what it was all about. He only talks about this one thing, and it's okay to continue to buy those things. And what upset to me is there's so much more about that. You know, he says a couple of things right. I mean, I do know that Hunts Point Terminal Market, the largest food distribution center in the entire world, right here in the South Bronx. Let's go on a field trip. It's a lot of fun. Get there early. 2% of the food grown there comes from the tri-state region of New York, Connecticut, and New Jersey. 2%. Christine Quinn, of course, and the Manhattan Borough President, Jerry Springer. Not Jerry Springer.
Scott Springer.
Jerry Springer is looking for new things since he's become Manhattan Borough President. You know, they're trying to push it up to 10%. We know that that's going to be a real challenge, right? Because right now, the only way that would work is if we choose that, push that up. Sounds great. 10%, just 10% of our food should come from local farms, right? That would mean half of New York would have to be cut down and replanted into farms. I'm not interested in that. We try that form of agriculture, and it doesn't work. So I understand kind of why some people are nervous about that. There's just not enough caloric intake. You know, it works if you're from Dubuque, Iowa, and you're trying to eat locally. That makes a lot more sense. But if there are 18 million of us in the metro things, and you do the little calculations, we know how much land we would need. Ultimately, you're going to have to buy some stuff that gets grown in other regions. Unless we do something else, which is what I would advocate for it. So what he got wrong, first of all, is what is the economic and environmental impact of eating that food that we're finding coming from other places, right? Most of the food in this country is still sprayed with all of these chemicals, these things that you don't need. This afternoon, I'll give you the list of the dirty dozen. I thought I brought it. Sorry about that. Of things never to buy, like spinach. Never buy spinach that's not organic. Just never. Don't ever do it, right? We have too much arsenic, cadmium, all these kinds of stuff in our soils. Don't ever buy rice from China anymore. That's all full of arsenic. But anyway, if you ever buy spinach, only buy it organic, right? Because spinach is great for taking up heavy metals into its system. Our body needs metals. We need zinc. We need iron. We need these things. We don't need cadmium. We don't need chromium. We don't need these things in large amounts, which go into our cells, plug in where zinc and those are supposed to be in their development of certain proteins, and mimic those and create bad kinds of substances. So there are things that we should never do. We also need local farms because of other reasons. We built a gigantic concrete place here in New York City. Every time the rain falls, that rain goes through our sewer system, goes right through it where you flush your toilet, and blasts out all of that untreated waste into the Hudson River. It's how New York City, Dobbs Ferry, Yonkers go up the line. That's how we do it. We all take rainwater that falls on the ground, and we send it through our sewer systems. And as we already know, there's not enough place for the rainwater. But imagine if those of us who are advocating for this, we had farms on each of these flat roofs all over New York, and the rain falls, it could be used for agriculture. You could put plants back. We know that there's a big debate in the United States about our energy production. They say, well, we need this much energy in the United States, and this much of it is being produced by alternative energies. Even if you were to double that, you would still not have enough energy. Right? That's their argument. I tell you, look at Lawrence Livermore Laboratories that say, well, that's true. We need this much energy. This much is waste. Total waste. Look how hot it is in this room right now, right? Some of you wouldn't be. And imagine if we were to redo our buildings or trap that heat away or convert all these silly light bulbs that we're using, and we could get rid of that, then double our green alternative energies, we'd know we're near the amount of energy we need. Urban farms would absorb all of that heat. Urban farming is the way of the future. It's what we need to do. Eventually, we're going to run out of oil. And rather than go off to somewhere in Iowa and cut down every bit of the natural landscape to grow our vegetables, we should grow our food here where we live. We have our floating farm out on the Hudson River called the Science Barge, and that's one of the things that we try to do is to show people that it's extremely possible to grow all the vegetables you want just using alternative energy and using the rain that falls here that we have. We know that food has a bigger impact on our water, our air, our soils. The way it's grown in the United States, that has to change. And all of those has to be put into the price of food as well. You know, Wendell Berry, the poet, got together a bunch of scientists, and they created this 50-year ag bill. And what they basically say is most of the food that we grow right now is annuals, right? As vegetables and crops and wheat. So every year we got to till the soil. Every year we inject lots of ammonium into the soil so it becomes ammonium nitrates type of thing. We then grow the plants, harvest it, and start it all over using these heavily impact tillage machines. Whereas a lot of places can use perennial plants, where all we're doing is harvesting and the plant comes back each year, we could switch more and more to perennial agriculture. That's your next wave to think about, is looking for foods that are not annuals but are perennials. Now, a lot of vegetables are annuals, but a lot of grains are grasses, and a lot of grasses are perennials, and there are perennial versions of everything, wheat, rice, all the stuff that we can get away from all these chemicals. So there are certain many things that we can do to change how agriculture happens in this country. We've had a lot of speakers here talk about it. But there was something else, the reason why I'm a big proponent now of urban agriculture, the urban agricultural revolution. And it does harken to a way back to what Jefferson thought of what also we lost when we went to just the means of production of all our foods in the hands of five industries. That we all need to reclaim agriculture to a certain extent and to put that back in this country. Because unless we have access to our own food and how it gets produced and how we eat it and all those things, if we just put that in the hand of five people whose only consideration is the bottom line, we will continue to eat junk. If we make agriculture more about what it used to be, about communities and healthy eating and creating a safety net for all of us, we will change food in this country. Urban farmers are the people who are going to help do that. Just look at how important they've been. Go to our roof. What are they just building on our roof?
Greenhouse,
right? Because even the school next door has realized and consulted with us a long time ago about the possibility of putting a farm up there and teaching kids more urban agriculture. I'm quite proud that I work for an organization that's trying to address this head on. And a few months ago, Senator Gillibrand came to Yonkers and she came before our science barge and she handed us a check for $190,000 that the USDA gave my organization to deal with it. And I'm happy to say that I'm in charge of that project and I've been working really, really hard on this. We are looking at Yonkers food policy and what needs to happen in Yonkers, not as just one thing. I don't want to just, you know, the terms of the grant is I will build more community gardens than we have, that I'll expand my CSA, my Community Support and Agriculture. But when I looked at it, and thinking about Jefferson, and thinking about all the things that we've heard, I realized that what I need to do in Yonkers, and what we need to do there as a team, is to change how food happens there. And the thing that we need to do is to put back control of the food more into the hand of the local people. So I'm creating what's called the Get Fresh Yonkers Farm Co-op, and training lots of people how to be urban farmers using that money and how to grow our own food. There are some difficulties about growing local farms. When I first moved up here, I'll never forget, I joined the CSA and I brought home some rainbow chard, or whatever that thing is. What the hell is that stuff? And I looked at it like many Southerners who are coming into New York from southern, more hotter regions, and looking at kale and chard and saying, what is this stuff? And why does it taste so nasty? And why would anybody ever want to eat this stuff, right? And the truth of the fact of the matter is that when I go up to the local farms now and work with the local farmers up there, that's the soil they have. That's the humidity. That's the light. They can grow those things, and they grow them beautifully. We're not going to be growing mangoes in Putnam County and bringing them in. We're not going to be growing many of the summer type of things. But you got a large number of people from Hispanics from the South and the Caribbean, those of us who moved to New York City, who are looking for those foods. I go to their poor little community gardens, I'm looking at them going, they're trying to grow watermelons. They'll never get a watermelon to grow in Yonkers. I mean, you'll get maybe this tiny little thing about this size and stuff. But it's just not enough, there's not enough temperature, heat, humidity, or light. But they do what I try to do. I try to grow watermelons right there behind the Riverdale Yonkers Society because I thought, well, they grow like hell at home. And then until years later when I took all my classes in agriculture, I realized what the hell's going on here. They're not going to grow. So we have a disconnect right now, and one of the things that has to happen in communities like Yonkers is that people like me need to learn how to eat our dishes that are like Tex-Mex or Cajun food. We need to learn how to eat those things using kale, using chard, using other things. The farmers have to work with us the best way they can, but right now with that disconnect, the problem with a lot of the farmers markets is they just become the right enclaves. Right? You go to a farmers market and everybody tends to look like us at a certain extent. Part of that, of course, is the economics of the farmer's market. But the second challenge is that what's grown there. I walk in the door and there's all this stuff. I don't know, garlic scapes were before I moved up here. And all this kind of stuff. We grow garlic in Texas, actually. I just didn't know what it was. Anyway, so we need to kind of recapture all that and make that work. There is a way for us to redo all of agriculture and make it more a part of us. The great thing about food is every time you make a purchase, you vote, they say. You make a selection of what that is. If you come to my workshop this afternoon, I'll tell you what to avoid, what not to buy, what things to buy as part of our outreach to help people understand that. But it's more about that. You know, I missed a board meeting because I went to the Yonkers City Council meeting. They invited me to be one of the guest speakers, and I went up there, and we're sitting there, and there was a vote whether or not to bring chickens to Yonkers. And they got chickens in the Bronx, right? They got chickens in Dobbs Ferry and all the towns around us. So what happened is, I said, okay, I'm sitting there with these people who grow chickens and have bees, and all of a sudden, the other side somehow got to put their first 12 people, the first 12 speakers heard were those people. I thought, I was trying to be polite and listen and not smirk, but I thought chickens looked like radioactive monsters that were attacking us and would chase our children down the street, which is what they said. And so I'm listening politely to this kind of stuff, and that bird droppings, of course, will kill you dead instantaneously if you touch it. And it just went on and on and on and on and on and on like this. And I understand, and what the argument, though, that upset me the most was a woman who said, well, this is a city, and a city is a city. If you're going to grow chickens or goats or any of those kind of stuff, you should grow them in the farms. And that's the point where I said, no, that's the wrong thing. That what we need is, we need food here. We need to grow food here. We need control of your food. Those people who want chickens, they want their own eggs. They don't want all that other crap anymore. They want their own food, and they want control their food, and we need to do that. I'm trying to work with the local schools up there to put in 4-H chapters, and now the Future Farmers of America chapters. Just change everything, and let's make New York City the major growing region that it can become and could be sustained. Wendell Berry, of course, can upset me in many ways because he can wax very conservative, but occasionally this kind of poet, agronomist, can put things right. And Wendell Berry, of course, wrote a great little thing I'll end with called The Mad Farmer Revolution. I think what he captures in here is that we do need this new way. We need a new sense of passion that every single person in this room can get involved in. You know, ethical religion has always been about what do you do? How do you live? The ethical way of life is how you act to make a difference out there, that like gardeners, we're trying to make an ethical culture, and we're going to garden this piece of earth that we have, and we're going to create it so that it nurtures and brings out our best. And I think a lot of that has to do with how we suddenly just come in and have another revolution about food. He calls it the Mad Farmer Revolution. The mad farmer, the thirsty one, went dry. When he had time, he threw a visionary high lonesome on the Holy Communion wine. It's an awesome event when an earthen man has drunk his fill of the blood of a god, people said, and got out of his way. He plowed the churchyard, the minister's wife, 3 graveyards and a golf course. In a parking lot, he planted a forest of little pines. He sanctified the groves, dancing at night in the oak shades with goddesses. He let a field of corn creep up and tassel like an Indian tribe on the courthouse lawn. Pumpkins ran out to the ends of their vines to follow him. Ripe plums and peaches reached into his pockets. Flowers sprang up in his tracks everywhere he stepped. And then his planter's eye fell on that parson's fine fair lady again. Oh, holy plowman, cried she, I am all grown up in weeds. Pray bring me back into good tilth. He tilled her carefully and laid her by, and she did bring forth others of her kind and others and some more. They sowed and reaped till all the countryside was filled with farmers and their brides sowing and reaping. When they died, they became 2 spirits in the woods. On their graves were written these words without sound. Here lies Saint Plowman. Here lies Saint Fertile Ground. Thank you.